Distinguished future physicians, welcome to Stomp on Step 1, the only free video series that helps you study more efficiently by focusing on the highest yield material. I'm Brian McDaniel, and I will be your guide on this journey through the herpes family of viruses. This is the fourth video in my playlist covering microbiology, and we are going to review genital herpes, cold sores, chickenpox, shingles, and mono. This is our first video covering viruses. Unfortunately, with the viruses, you have to memorize how many strands the genome is, whether it is DNA or RNA, and if the virus has an envelope. This is perhaps my least favorite thing to learn for step one, but you just have to grit your teeth and get through it. Some of the questions on the exam require you to have this information, as it will sort of be a two-part question. For example, based on the question stem, you may know the answer is herpes simplex, but when you look at the answer choices, herpes simplex isn't an option. You will instead see something like a double-stranded DNA virus. If you don't know how to translate your answer into these defining characteristics of the virus, you can't get that question right. So we will be referencing this table as we go through the high-yield viruses. This obviously isn't an exhaustive list, but it has most of the important examples. And here is the table listing whether or not the viruses have a lipid outer layer called an envelope. You can see here herpes listed as having an envelope. In the general population, the term herpes is used almost exclusively to describe genital herpes simplex. There are actually 8 members of the family of Herpesviridae, aka herpes viruses, and most of them are high yield for the exam. However, we will not discuss all 8 of the viruses in this video. Human herpes virus 6, HHV6, and human herpes virus 7, HHV7, are very low yield for the exam, so we will skip them. We will also hold off on discussing human herpes virus 8, HHV8, or Kaposi sarcoma, until a later video that will discuss HIV and AIDS in depth. This family includes some of the most common and contagious infections in the general population. Over 90% of people have one or more herpes infections. However, for a huge majority of the time, these infections are not active. After an initial symptomatic period, they have a prolonged latent phase where the inactive viruses hide from the immune system. In some cases, there are sporadic periods of reactivation where the patient again becomes symptomatic. The symptomatic periods of these infections are usually self-limited, but there is no cure to eliminate the virus or prevent reoccurrences completely. Some patients don't even know they have the infection, as the primary infection can be asymptomatic or very mild. The diagnosis of these viruses is usually made clinically. However, there are tests that can aid in the diagnosis. A Zoster test, aka Zoster smear, is a rapid test that can be performed when a herpes virus is suspected. A skin vesicle is broken open and smeared on a slide with a specific stain. Microscopically, if multinucleated giant cells with intranuclear inclusions are visible, it is a positive result. Here is a picture of what a positive Zoster test looks like. There are 2 types of herpes simplex, HSV1 and HSV2. HSV1 presents primarily on the lips or mouth, aka cold sores or orolabial herpes, while HSV2 presents primarily on the genitalia. HSV2 is most often an STD, while HSV1 is mostly spread by saliva. However, there is a significant overlap between types, and you can get both viruses via either route and in either area of the body. In both cases, herpes simplex can be asymptomatic or cause painful, fluid-filled blisters on the skin and mucous membranes that can progress to ulcerations. Genital herpes typically has multiple lesions, while orolabial herpes most commonly has a single lesion. Here is a picture of orolabial herpes, And I think you get the point, so I'll spare you from looking at pictures of genital herpes. There may also be non-specific symptoms before the lesions occur, called a viral prodrome. The prodrome can include fever, malaise, and tingling in the area that later shows the lesions. HSV1 and HSV2 are lifelong infections with asymptomatic periods where the virus lays dormant in sensory neurons. The virus mostly lays dormant in the trigeminal ganglia after orolabial herpes, while genital herpes usually results in the virus laying dormant in the sacral ganglia. There is currently no cure for the virus, but treatment usually involves antiviral drugs to reduce the severity, duration, and risk of transmission. Oral antivirals, such as acyclovir, are usually the treatment of choice. So to review, HSV1 more commonly has singular lip or mouth lesions, lays dormant in the trigeminal nerve, and is transmitted by saliva. HSV2 more commonly has multiple genital lesions, lays dormant in the sacral ganglia, and is an STD. However, you need to remember this is an oversimplification, and there's a lot of overlap between these two viruses. One last thing about herpes simplex is that HSV1 is the most common cause of viral encephalitis. We will cover this topic in more depth in the neuro videos, but I'll touch on it briefly here now. It most often affects the temporal lobe. This presents clinically with altered mental status, fever, and in some cases, seizures. Immunosuppressed individuals are at the greatest risk for herpes encephalitis. Lumbar puncture shows high lymphocytes in the CSF, and imaging may show changes in the temporal lobe. Both HHV1 and HHV2 are also torch infections that can lead to neonatal herpes. We will save that topic for a later video. Varicella zoster virus, VZV, or HHV3, is more commonly referred to as chickenpox during the primary infection and shingles during the secondary infection. Both of these present clinically with an erythematous red, vesicular, fluid-filled rash that progresses to scabbing. VZV is primarily spread by respiratory secretions but can also be spread via direct contact with the lesion. Chickenpox, aka varicella, presents primarily in children when they are first exposed to the varicella virus. It affects non-immune hosts, meaning you can only get chickenpox once in your life if you have an intact immune system. Chickenpox is usually benign and primarily characterized by severe itchiness over the entire body as the virus spreads through the blood. The lesions start on the trunk and head and then spread to the extremities. Sometimes they describe the rash as being in a variety of stages at once, which means you can see red lumps, fluid-filled vesicles, pustules, and scabs at the same time. Here is a picture of chickenpox for you to look at. Symptoms usually resolve over a couple weeks without any treatment. However, calamine lotion, trimming fingernails, wearing gloves, and/or acetaminophen are often used for symptomatic relief. The individual also needs to be isolated to prevent spread of the contagious disease. In recent years, the varicella vaccine, aka chickenpox vaccine, has been developed. The vaccine drastically reduces the risk of getting the disease while also decreasing the severity of the disease for those that still get it. After chickenpox, the body is not able to completely remove the virus. A small number of virus particles survive for decades in the sensory ganglia, primarily the cranial and thoracic ganglia. As the patient becomes elderly, their immune system becomes weakened, and the same varicella zoster virus can become reactivated to cause shingles. The skin lesions of shingles, aka zoster, only occur in a single dermatome. Therefore, the rash appears in strips across the skin that do not cross the midline. This localized and well-demarcated area of skin represents the specific area of skin that is innervated by the sensory nerve that the virus has been reactivated in. Here is a picture to review the dermatomes from anatomy. Shingles can occur anywhere on the body, but the chest and back are the most common areas affected. The rash is grouped erythematous maculopapular lesions. Shingles is primarily characterized by burning, pain, and fever, but there can also be a tingling sensation in the dermatome even before the lesions arise. This prodrome can also include nonspecific symptoms like malaise, headache, and nausea. Here are some pictures of shingle rashes. The only pictures I could find are actually of pretty young people, but remember, this is going to be much more common in elderly patients. The symptoms usually resolve spontaneously over a couple weeks. However, antivirals can be used if shingles is diagnosed early on, as it can lessen the severity and duration. Pain medications and antipyretics can be used for symptom control. Post-herpetic neuralgia is when the patient's pain persists for months even after the rash has resolved. This pain can be very severe and is difficult to treat. There is also a vaccine for shingles called the Zoster vaccine, trade name Zostavax. It is a live, attenuated vaccine that can be thought of as just a stronger version of the varicella vaccine. A one-time dose is recommended for adults starting at age 60. Epstein-Barr virus, EBV, or HHV4 for short, is the primary cause of infectious mononucleosis, aka mono. The virus can be transmitted in saliva, hence the name the kissing disease. It should be noted, while sexual activity increases the risk of getting EBV, it is not an STD. EBV infection is usually asymptomatic, but causes mono in some individuals. When symptomatic, mono primarily presents with flu-like symptoms of fatigue, pharyngitis, sore throat, headache, and lymphadenopathy in large lymph nodes. The lymphadenopathy may be accompanied by an exudative pharyngitis similar to strep throat. The symptoms last for a few weeks and are most commonly seen in teenage patients. Mono is usually self-limited and no specific treatment is needed. However, infected individuals should avoid contact sports, football, cheerleading, etc., for about a month because splenomegaly increases the risk of splenic rupture. EBV is also associated with nasopharyngeal carcinoma, Burkitt's lymphoma, and other cancers. EBV infects the B lymphocytes, mainly in the pharynx, and signals these B lymphocytes to proliferate. In response to these infected B cells, cytotoxic CD8 T cells become activated and proliferate also. The white blood cell count for infected individuals is high, and that there is a high number of lymphocytes or T cells, greater than 50% of the overall white blood cells. However, B cells on the CBC are near normal, as most of the B cells are in the lymph nodes and cannot be seen in the peripheral blood. In EBV infections, the CD8 T cells take on a characteristic appearance referred to as atypical lymphocytes, aka reactive lymphocytes. They are larger and have more cytoplasm than normal appearing lymphocytes. This finding should stick out as a buzzword for EBV, but remember that this finding is not specific to Epstein-Barr. Atypical lymphocytes can be seen on microscopy, like in this picture. Cytomegalovirus, CMV, or HHV5, infects B cells and can be transmitted via saliva, similar to EBV. CMV can also be transmitted sexually, through blood transfusions or organ transplants. HHV5 infection is primarily asymptomatic, but can cause mono just like EBV. Immunosuppression is a key risk factor for becoming symptomatic, and symptoms are more often seen in AIDS patients or following a transplant. Immunosuppressed individuals may also have invasive cytomegalovirus that most often causes interstitial pneumonia. Cytomegalovirus can cause atypical lymphocytes like EBV, but histologically, CMV is more often associated with owl eyes. This owl eyes sign is tough to distinguish from the Reed-Sternberg cells of Hodgkin's lymphoma. Here is a couple pictures of the owl eyes. This appearance is caused by infective lymphocytes accumulating basophilic inclusions. CMV is also another torch infection, but we will save congenital CMV for a later video. Both EBV and CMV can cause mono. Therefore, differentiating between the two based solely on clinical scenario is difficult. For cases of mono, a monospot test, aka mononucleosis test, or heterophile antibody test, is used to determine the causal virus. This test is used to detect heterophile antibodies, a type of antibody that reacts with proteins from other animals. A sample of the patient's serum is added to sheep or horse blood, and if the heterophile antibody is present in the patient's blood, it will cause the animal blood to agglutinate, clump up. A positive monospot test means the symptoms are caused by EBV, and a negative means something else is. Thank you to Jeff Patterson from the UK for his generous donation on stomponstep1.com that helped make this video possible. If you would like the ability to either speed up or slow down my videos or anything on YouTube, click on this orange box here. That will take you to a video where I show you how to do that. The next video in the microbiome section will cover viral hepatitis. In order to be brought directly to that video, you can click on this black box here if you are watching on a computer. Thank you so much for watching, and good luck with the rest of your studying.